So Tokyo Revengers Christmas Showdown. I mean, it's been a hot minute since the end of season one, and I was still getting rage comments. Honestly, up until a few months ago, there'd always be a person who would pop up on the last review I did for this one being like, how in the actual they ended it like that? Like, when are we ever getting more? And we're officially here. This season has officially kicked off, and I mean, Saturdays are just so packed. I'm still trying to figure out the schedule of how I'm doing things. I might be able to do these on Saturday, we'll see, but we're talking about it nonetheless. And I mean, we last left off with basically what seemed to be a death. Like, I was like, okay, gunshot is what's gonna happen to Takemichi. And this episode, it doesn't sugarcoat things. It doesn't give you a recap. It doesn't refresh your memory. It just says, we're carrying on. And honestly, I kind of respect him. Not gonna lie, I forget most of the characters' names, but I will over time remember things as anyone does. But the fact that they didn't beat around the bush, they just kicked in and then literally kicked our boy in because he's like, is this how this gang's supposed to operate? Is this is what happens to women on the street? And just to see the rage and to see how screwed the future actually ended up, I think at this point we can just sum it up as Automichi, you know, Takemichi when he's in his automated form, when he's in one, either the past or the future, more or less like, hey, like, if we leave that boy in charge, shit just goes wrong. And we end up seeing what gangster Takemichi can do. I mean, of course, he ends up crying because Takemichi will always end up crying. But the fact of the matter was, like, there's his VA in that one moment in the recording, that actually gave me chills. Add in Evil Mikey and how he got so corrupted. Banger way to return. Now, I do got a full live reaction to this episode available on the Patreon, so consider supporting if you want to see that. But let's talk about this one. This has definitely been one of my more anticipated sequels for a couple of years. I really loved what I saw with season one of Tokyo Revengers, and honestly, this one, I knew eventually we would see more. It was a matter of time. Some people gave up hope a lot sooner than I was expecting, but it was here. I didn't jump into the manga. I held off, and honestly, I'm glad I did, because there was some interesting direction choices they went this episode, because honestly, I mean, at first, I was like, holy shit, man, you're just throwing me right in here. I was a little overwhelmed at first, but I don't really think that was a bad thing. I mean, it's on me if I want to rewatch something to be completely refreshed, so the fact that they just threw me in, I'm like, what the hell is Mikey doing here? I was like, oh shit, that's not Mikey, just kind of looked like him from that angle. And the fact that, because in this current timeline, how everything was happening, it wasn't our boy who ended up working with the detective, it was two of the others. And the fact that, honestly, I don't know if I was the only one feeling this, because we know every time he comes back, they always know each other, right? They're connected. So no matter how much it changes, they always know that, hey, we can shake hands, we can fix this. And it just seemed, I was like, you put my boy in cuffs, you're acting like you have no idea who he is. And I was like, oh shit, is it really that broken? I was truly thinking that what was going to happen is the first part of the season would be him trying to either make him remember or basically just get a handshake in so he can go back in the past. Makes sense though that he basically, well, he had no choice but to arrest him, but he still understood the situation. But I mean, I've been saying it pretty much every time he comes back and he fails. No one person can deal with that weight. Now, not to say Nato doesn't have his own shit cut out for him the number of times he has to remember his sister dying or just feeling like a failure, but it is completely different than what Takemichi's dealing with. This boy literally has no idea what to do. The fact that he rose up the ranks and just turned into some evil scum lord, even if, like, yes, he was manipulated, the amount of just being like, I give up attitude, I couldn't blame the guy at all. But I'm glad that in very Tokyo Revengers fashion, yeah, you fall down, hell, you get tossed off the stairs. But you get back up and you say, like, I mean, if he doesn't succeed this time, is there actually a way for him to come back? Because he's being taken off, right? So there's not going to be those one-on-one meetings as he's now arrested. So unless he massively changes the present slash future, I mean, what's going to happen if he fails, comes back, and, you know, he's in jail and he can't shake his hand? Like, do we just sit out? Because we know how the time travel works, right? It is like 12 years from where he goes back or forward. So, I mean, it's not looking good. But I think this did a great job at just throwing us in. It may be a little overwhelming for some people because they're like, shit, it's been a couple years, I don't remember. I mean, that's on us, right? If we really want to remember every little detail, all the fine-tooth comb moments, that's on us to rewatch. But I think it's very easy to remember the general idea, the key character moments, and the fact that we know the grand idea. Save his girlfriend, save the sister, and stop Mikey from turning evil. And the fact that we need so many different people alive to influence him, both positive and the ones who influence him negative, we gotta get rid of. Though, I just don't know, the whole My Hero moment and the fact that every time they change the future, she still ends up dead. That's always been a big topic of discussion. see a time traveler too? Is it just something personal that he just always goes after her for one reason or another? I'm generally curious though if the direction isn't going to be like pushing him out or even killing him, but what if there's a way to like get him on his side to the point that, because I'm kind of curious if maybe the direction they're going is a lot of times she ends up dead because maybe he just sees her as a distraction and Takemichi needs to focus on the gang sort of a thing. Maybe that's currently what's happening and maybe they need to sway him that way, but I don't know. I really don't know the solution. I've never known the solution for Tokyo Revengers. There's been moments where I had an idea, I was like, maybe if they sway this character or he can become captain, maybe that will change everything. And then it kind of happens and it's like not even close to being enough and we end up seeing gangster Takemichi just completely lose his cool. And I mean, Christmas Showdown, I remember, I think it was around the middle point of season one, I heard people say like they were really excited for the Christmas Showdown arc and they knew they weren't getting it in that season, but in season two it would be a banger. So I'm excited to see what's going to happen. I mean, generally, you wouldn't think of Christmas as the most gangsta way to go about things, but I think that's what's going to make it so bloody because, seriously, Christmas is such a beautiful time of the year, and for what's probably going to happen in Tokyo Revengers fashion is going to make it a very red Christmas rather than a very white Christmas, and I don't know where we go from here, but I'm excited, if not worried, to see. I thought it was kind of funny, though, with how, like, it's such a... It's always a good thing, but it's such a whiplash of emotions. You go from our boys breaking down and crying because they're just so stressed and fed up with the BS, and you just casually throw him bowling, and he's just like, he's on his third strike in a row. And of course, he's crying. It's Takemichi. He's always going to. But just to see like the cute, adorable whiplash going from helpless, hopeless, and my boy's now in jail and in cuffs and never's gonna shake hands again, to having casual bowling adventures, and then the person next to you is one of the people we have to worry about given what they were establishing in this episode. So, insane times to say the least. I mean, the only thing I can hope is that Mikey will be able to be saved. Like, I just don't know, because, like, this is a boy who can easily create something so beautiful or become the most evil scumbag on the planet. And it's all based on such little moments that a lot of the times Takemichi has no control over, and then when he tries to direct it, it just turns it sometimes what seems to be for the worse. But I do like the fact that our best detective here, even seeing the future that he ended up creating, he recognizes you got places. You really rose up the ranks. Yes, it wasn't what we wanted necessarily, but progress is being made, even though it's still negative in so many different aspects. It's just imagining having to do something like Takemichi, more people would be jumping off buildings or just crying in a corner, because how do you deal with that burden? I don't think anyone could really deal with that burden. I know I couldn't, but damn. Leave it to our boy. He may cry, but the nerves, the courage that this guy has is second to none in a lot of ways. But thoughts and feelings yourself on the first episode. What did you think of the return? Did you remember a lot of what happened in the prior season? Were you kind of like, oh shit, I'm just kind of thrown in? Or whatever you're feeling, do let me know, because I think this is a great first episode and it's going to be a fun one to discuss this season. So thoughts and feelings down below. Leave a like if you enjoyed. Subscribe if you're new around here. Like I mentioned, full live reaction is available on the Patreon. Going to have those every week as well. So do consider if you so wish. So until next time, everyone, please take care and have a good one.